hard to pick just one main topic because there are so many layers in the novel. On one level, it's a book about life in prison because it's narrated from prison by a woman called Memory. But at the same time, she's recalling or remembering her past life. So it's also a book about history and about memory and about the things that we choose to remember. It's also a book about the different ways that people of different races came to find each other. Because the normal narrative of a place like Zimbabwe when you're writing about race is always the antagonistic relationship between black and white. And I wanted to look at a different kind of relationship because I'm interested in the outsiders, the outliers. I'm interested in the people who defied the expectations of their societies. So at the heart of this novel is also a relationship between a white man and an albino girl who is supposed to be black but actually looks white without having the whiteness, you know, the privilege that comes with whiteness. So it was a way for me to also obliquely, indirectly, look at race and racial relations in Zimbabwe. Yeah, it's hard for me to be crystal clear without giving away the plot. So I will say that at the heart of the novel is a relationship between a man called Lloyd Hendricks and a young girl called Memory. And Memory believes, and it may be true, it may not be true, the reader will find out as the book develops, Memory believes that she has been sold to Lloyd by her parents. And we get to find out about how it is that she came to live with him, and we get to find out the nature of their relationship, which doesn't seem to be what it appears to be. Yes, appearances are very important to the book because one of the themes, as I explained before, is memory and the things we remember. And we remember visually, as well as, of course, viscerally through, there's something called muscle memory, which I love that expression, muscle memory. It's what sportsmen use to move their, you know, to move their muscles, especially cricketers. My son is a cricketer. So muscle memory is when your muscle remembers to do certain actions. And muscle memory is also something that you feel if you have gone through trauma, if you've gone through abuse. Like if you come across something that disturbs you, you immediately flinch, you know, so you have a memory in your body. But there's also the memory of the mind. And the memory of the mind is very much associated with images and sounds, you know, the things that you feel through your senses as well. So appearances are very important for the book in that the things that appear in a particular way may actually be misremembered or may actually be something completely different. I wanted it to be a first-person narrative, but because I was a very inexperienced writer, I didn't really trust the first-person narrative. Because I always thought, if I'm using the I voice, there must be a reason for it. So that's why I invented this framing device of the journalist that she's writing to. And it made me more secure that the I is being directed at somebody. So she's writing the story of her life, and it's a conscious narration. And that idea of a conscious narration allowed me to play a little bit with the plot, you know. So it's a novel that I would classify as a slow reveal. We slowly find out why things happened the way that they did. And I think using that I voice, that first person voice, but directed to a particular person, allowed me to develop the story better. I think, and this is going to horrify my publishers around the world, I think I'm a short story writer. I think I'm going to write novels because I want to write novels, but also because, you know, the novel is the expected product from a writer. But I love short stories because short stories allow me to experiment with different voices, and I love to take on different voices. I like to write as people that I'm not, as men, as, you know, white old ladies, you know, old white men, you know, Jewish men, you know. I love to write as different characters. So short stories allow me that scope, whereas the novel is a little bit more constricted. But the novel took me a long time to write because I just had so much anxiety. There's a wonderful expression in English, it's called the imposter syndrome, when you believe that people are going to find out that you're a fraud. So I suffered terribly from that. But what really sparked the novel is a story I read in a Zimbabwean newspaper that there was only one woman on death row. And that fact absolutely terrified me, and it haunted me for a long time because I kept thinking, she must be the loneliest woman in Zimbabwe. It's First of all, it's not the most pleasant place to be for anyone, but to be the only woman on death row, how isolating and how alienated her life must be. So I started to write a novel about a woman on death row. And at the time I began to write it, about 6 or 7 years ago, I didn't quite know who she was, how she got there. But the more I began to write, the more she came to me. Two of my favorite novels that are, I consider them literary fiction, although they were written by two wonderful women who are considered crime writers, are A Duck Adapted Eye by Barbara Vine, who is the persona of Ruth Rendell, and also a wonderful book also by Ruth Rendell, actually it's the same person, A Judgment in Stone. So Ruth Rendell wrote as Barbara Vine for certain purposes. And those books that she wrote as Barbara Vine, you know what the crime is, you know who committed the crime, but you want to know why. And I love that kind of why done it instead of a who done it. Because for me, I think it takes a real, you know, understanding of psychology, of human psychology, to go into the details of why a particular crime happened the way it did. And the other writer that I really love in that respect is P.D. James, who is, you know, she doesn't do blood and gore and guts and guns and all that kind of thing, but she does this amazingly realistic psychological studies of crime and why crime happens. So in a way, the Book of Memory is an ode to both women, to Ruth Rendell and to P.D. James, without actually being a thriller or a whodunit.